In today's video, I want to share some pointers for stitching panoramas in Lightroom. Adobe first released the panorama stitching in Lightroom 6, and as I'm recording this, we're already at version 11.5. Let's start with this example, where I want to merge two images. I've already processed these from RAW files, and I've saved them in the PDF format. To stitch the two images in Lightroom, first select both images in the Lightroom Library grid view. I'm doing this by holding down my Command key whilst clicking each image that I want to merge. If you're using a Windows PC, that's your Control key. Don't worry about the order you select the images, Lightroom will work out how to merge them. After selecting the images, I can choose the Photo Merge option from the Lightroom Photo menu. Alternatively, I can right-click on one of the two thumbnails and select the Photo Merge option from the pop-up menu. Then, in the Merge menu, choose the Panorama option to open the merging dialog. When the image opens, Lightroom generates a preview of the stitched panorama. Notice how the individual images are distorted to allow them to be stitched. The wider the angle of lens you use to capture these frames, the more distortion that's needed. The distortion is what creates this white space around the edge of the frame. How much distortion is needed also depends on these three projections, which you can change. These have strange names like spherical, cylindrical, and perspective. I won't explain what these mean because it doesn't really help you create better panoramas. Instead, we need to look at what happens when we stitch the projections. The strangest projection in most cases is the perspective option. This tends to produce a strong distortion unless you're using a long telephoto lens. Because of this, a lot of photographers ignore the perspective projection, but I'll show you a way to use it in a minute. As with the other projections, the wider the angle of lens used, the more distortion it creates. Both the spherical and cylindrical projections tend to work better with wide-angle lenses. If you compare the two, you can see that they're quite similar, although the spherical projection tends to produce a flatter panorama. We then have controls that help us deal with the white empty space around the image. When I click the auto crop option, you can see that it removes all the white space by cropping away part of the image. Lightroom is trying to maximize the available image whilst cropping out the unwanted space. The problem with this though when stitching images shot with a wide angle lens is that you can lose large areas of the foreground and sky. The problem's the same with the other projections as well. One advantage of the crop is that it's possible to change the crop area after stitching the panorama. All we need to do is edit the panorama in the Lightroom Develop module. Then, if we select the crop tool, we can see the original image and the crop that's been applied. Because the auto crop is non-destructive, you can still resize or even remove it in the editing later. An alternative to cropping away the unwanted white space is to fill it. We can do this by clicking the Fill Edges option. Lightroom then samples parts of the image, using them to fill the empty space. Often it does an extremely good job of replacing the empty space with a realistic detail as it's done here. Despite this, you still need to check these areas closely after stitching is complete. Unfortunately, we can't check the preview in the dialog for problems. Whilst we can zoom in on the preview, the size is limited to help maintain Lightroom performance. Having said that, if you can see a problem in the preview, then it's probably not worth continuing without changing settings. Another control we can use to remove white space around the image is the Boundary Warp slider. As you increase the level of the slider, it distorts the individual images being stitched to remove the white space. This works with all three projections, including the perspective projection. In fact, using the Boundary Warp with the perspective projection can often produce an excellent panorama. Using the Boundary Warp, it becomes easier to see the differences between the three projections. Although the Boundary Warp can produce good results, it does suffer from a problem. This is probably most noticeable in landscape images, where you'll find distant hills and horizons don't quite line up. It's most likely to happen when merging images shot with a wide-angle lens because they need more distortion to stitch them. If you do find problems, try using a combination of the Boundary Warp and the Fill Edges option. Although it's a little slower to generate previews, it can fix a lot of the problems you see when using either of these controls on their own. The final option in the dialog to mention is the Create Stack. Image stacks are a great feature in Lightroom to help you organize your images. When we use this option, Lightroom groups the images being stitched together with the finished panorama in a stack. You then know these images are all part of the stitch panorama, so you don't risk deleting one of them by mistake, thinking they aren't very good. Now, just before I merge these images, I want to highlight this warning message. Because the images I'm stitching aren't raw files, Lightroom can't automatically match the lens profiles. When this happens, Lightroom might not produce the best optical quality in the panorama. In this example, I've already applied the lens profile correction to the images before trying to stitch them, so this shouldn't be an issue. Ideally though, it's much better to start with the raw files rather than using processed images as I've done here. Let's merge these now because I have some other examples I want to share in a moment. Once the stitching's finished, Lightroom groups the two images together with the new panorama that's been added to the Lightroom catalogue. If I magnify the preview image and check the edges, you can see the quality of the area that's been filled. In our example, the two images being stitched were horizontal, producing a long, thin panorama. This time we have a series of vertical images, which are shot with the camera rotated at 90 degrees. When I stitch these together, it creates a photo that's more like a single horizontal frame than a panorama. The advantage of having the camera vertical is we create a higher resolution image. It requires more frames to produce the panorama, but you have a lot more flexibility to crop the image. When shooting a panorama sequence, try to overlap the frames by about a third. Most cameras have a rule of thirds grid which you can turn on and which helps you when trying to overlap images. In this next example, we have three horizontal frames to stitch together. This time, notice how small the area of white space is around the edge of the frame. It also doesn't change much even when I change to different projections. This is because I used a long lens rather than a wide-angle lens like in the first example. When I shot these images, I also had the camera on a tripod and spent some time levelling the base. Because of that, the camera stayed level as I moved from left to right to shoot each frame. That's also helped to reduce the white space, but there's something else I want you to notice in this image. Because the sea is moving, Lightroom can't create a good blend between the images in those areas. This produced an edge between the frames in two places which I can see. When this happens, you may need to use the Lightroom clone and healing brushes to hide the join. After that, you can finish your editing in Lightroom, where you might find the tips in this video useful. It has some helpful ideas to help you make the most of Lightroom's more advanced features. I hope that you've enjoyed today's video, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you soon.